wiry, greasy hair, beard to the chest, ribboned with blood, furtive eyes darting from here to there, naked, no shoes on his feet to cover them from the rocks on the ground, or clothes on his skin to protect him from the rocks in his hands. He beats himself with stones, bruises blotch his skin, sores and gashes attract flies. His house is in a cemetery, limestone caves cut out of the cliffs along the shoreline. He prefers to live among the dead than the living. His home, which pleases the living, they are terrified by him. Townspeople and travelers walk wide detours around the cemetery where he lives to avoid him. He has cracked shackles on his ankles and broken chains on his wrists. They can't hold him. Nothing holds him. The people of the town are left with a problem. And you and I are left with a picture. A picture of the work of Satan. A glimpse of the wild man shows Satan's dreams, his desires for you and me. Let's look at this wild guy. It's in the book of Mark, chapter 5. If you'd like to follow along in the Bibles we have under the seats in front of you, it's on page 1006. Mark 5. They went across the lake to the region of the Gerasenes. This is Jesus and his disciples. When Jesus got out of the boat, a man with an impure spirit, or you could say an evil spirit or a demon, came from the tombs to meet him. This man lived in the tombs. Satan's first goal for you and me, and a characteristic we find of demon possession, is moral and physical filth. This man, possessed by a demon, lives among the tombs, among dead bodies in limestone caves. You always find this element of filth with demons, living in the midst of dirt or rubbish or causing moral pollution. It's no accident that the rise of the demonic in our day has been paralleled by the rise of terrorism and off-the-chart gang shootings and the spread of pornography. Men caught in the web of pornography or strip clubs or prostitution talk about a sense of deep darkness around them. Evil spirits love filth. A second characteristic of demon possession is extraordinary strength. Verse 3, no one could bind him anymore, not even with a chain, for he had often been chained hand and foot, but he tore the chains apart and broke the irons on his feet. No one was strong enough to pursue him. The vividness of this account shows this is an eyewitness testimony that Mark gives that he got from the Apostle Peter. In Mark 1:26, Mark tells about another demon, and it says, the impure spirit shook the man violently. We see tremendous strength with evil spirits. In Mark 9, Mark tells about another demon possession. Whenever it seizes him, it throws him to the ground. This is the father telling the Jesus about his son. He foams at the mouth, gnashes his teeth, and becomes rigid. I asked your disciples to drive out the spirit, but they could not. When the spirit saw Jesus, it immediately threw the boy into convulsions. He fell to the ground and rolled around, foaming at the mouth. You see with evil spirits this extraordinary strength. In The Exorcist 2, a movie that came out in 2000, based on a true story of a Jesuit priest who expelled a demon from a 14-year-old boy in Mount Rainier, Maryland in 1949, first reported in the Washington Post and then later documented in a book by William Peter Blatty, a demon-possessed girl, they used a girl in the movie, had such strength that she punched a psychiatrist in his Johnson and he doubled over in pain for several minutes. demons have supernatural strength. Another desire Satan has for you and me, and a characteristic of demon possession, is self-destructive and suicidal tendencies. Night and day, verse 5, among the tombs and in the hills, he would cry out and cut himself with stones. This man could be found wildly running around in the cemetery, cutting himself with stones, trying to take his life and put himself out of his agony. In verse 13, we see that Jesus expels the demons, and they go into a herd of pigs, and then they rush over the cliff into the Lake of Galilee. This demonstrates the ultimate intention of demons with respect to us. Their express purpose is to destroy God's creation and to keep us from Christ. More often than not, mass murders and terrorist attacks are incited by demonic activity. Who knows how many suicides have come from people listening to Satan's lies? You're worthless. Nobody cares about you. Why don't you take yourself out of your pain? Take your life. No one's going to miss you. A fourth desire that Satan has for you and me, and a characteristic of demon possession, is a battle against Jesus. Verse 6, when he saw Jesus from a distance, this is the demon-possessed man, he ran and fell on his knees in front of him. He shouted at the top of his voice, "What do you want with me, Jesus, Son of the Most High God? In God's name, don't torture me." For Jesus had said to him, "Come out of this man, you impure spirit." The demon immediately recognizes Jesus. People in the four Gospels often do not understand who Jesus is, but demons know instinctively. The demon is surprised to find Jesus in a Gentile area. This is in what we call the West Bank today, across the Jordan River. And it's an area called Decapolis, 10 Greek cities, one of which is Damascus, which is still standing today. In Mark 1:24, another account about a demon recognized Jesus and said, "I know who you are, the Holy One of God." Demons recognize the authority of Jesus, but they cause those whom they influence or inhabit a coldness or deadness toward Christ. There's an inability of the person to even say the name Jesus. There's an aversion to reading the Bible and praying, a tendency to fall asleep during sermons. Maybe that's your problem. There's a foul language. There's an hostility towards Christianity. The demons hate Christ. So they try to shut off their human hosts from contact with Christ, even though they recognize his authority over them. A final characteristic that we find in this account that's a characteristic of demon possession is dual personality. Verse 8, then Jesus asked him, "What is your name?" We find here that demons always have names. "My name is Legion," he replied, "for we are many." Notice there's a man and there's a voice speaking out of the man. Sometimes the person will be perfectly normal and kind of seem just okay, and at other times there'll be a change in personality and a change in the timbre of the voice. The demon takes over. Since a demon or a group of demons inhabit the person takes on a split personality. Sometimes this has led doctors to incorrectly diagnose demon possession as a case of split personality. And they call it, schizophrenia. In the movie, The Exorcist 2, the family spared no expense, no effort to find out what was wrong with their 14-year-old daughter. They took her to doctors, they did a spinal tap, and they determined that her great strength was attributed to muscle spasms. Her personality changes they attributed to epilepsy. But the diagnosis did not cover all the bases. So then the parents took her to a psychiatrist. He had diagnosed her as having acute schizophrenia. In one sense, he was right. But his diagnosis did not account for the cause of the dual personality. His diagnosis did not account for the other manifestations, marching sounds and under the bed and objects levitating around the girl and her chair tilting when she was sitting in it, and then her skin erupting in red, livid red eruptions. So since the doctor's explanation did not cover all the horrors they were experiencing with their daughter, they turned to the church. A Jesuit priest recognized her dual personality as a case of demon possession. While still a student at Georgetown University, William Peter Blatty read about this unusual account, and he became fascinated with demon possession. He turned it into a book, The Exorcist, which sold 6 million copies and has been translated into 18 languages. William Blatty, when pressed for why he wrote the book, The Exorcist, said it was to persuade those who do not believe that there's a case to be made for the supernatural and to offer the possibility that there is a supernatural force of evil in the universe whose game plan is to convince us that he does not exist. In Mark's gospel, we find no less than 8 accounts of Jesus casting out demons or battling with Satan. Mark 5 records Jesus' most famous exorcism, verse 10. And he begged, this is the demon, Jesus again and again not to send them out of the area. A large herd of pigs was feeding on the nearby hillside. The demons begged Jesus, send us among the pigs, allow us to go into them. He gave them permission. And the impure spirits came out, went into the pigs. The herd, about 2,000 in number, rushed down the steep bank into the lake and were drowned. Now, some people think exorcisms we find in the New Testament are just primitive accounts of Jesus dealing with insanity or epilepsy. But just like William Blatty wrote The Exorcist to prove that some human behavior cannot be explained by medical science, but only the reality of the demonic, Mark wants us to know that this is an historically accurate account of a real demon living in a real man healed by Jesus through a real exorcism. So why do we read this account? What difference does this make in our lives? I think this makes a difference in at least 4 ways. First, Jesus prayed and calls us to pray. In Mark 1:35, we read that Jesus got up very early in the morning, went off to a desolate place, and prayed. He lived a life of prayer. And he calls us to do the same. In chapter 9, Mark tells about a man who came to Jesus and said, a man in the crowd answered, Teacher, I brought you my son, who is possessed by a spirit that has robbed him of speech. Whenever it seizes him, it throws him to the ground. He foams at the mouth, gnashes his teeth, and becomes rigid. I asked your disciples to drive out the spirit, but they could not. This man was frustrated. I imagine he tried every doctor, every priest, and no one could help him. Then he heard about Jesus, that Jesus cast out demons, and he healed people. And so he came to the town where Jesus was, but when he got there, Jesus was gone. And so he asked his disciples, can you help me? But they couldn't drive out the spirit. Then when Jesus returned, he rushed over to the man and told him about his problem, and Jesus cast out the demon and healed his son. Later, the disciples asked why they couldn't cast him out, and Jesus replied, verse 29, this kind can come out only by prayer. What Jesus meant was there are some matters we encounter that are too big for us. And those things can be dealt with only by prayer. You may be facing something overwhelming in your life. You've been stopped in your tracks and you say, I don't know what to do. Health crisis maybe? Marriage problem? Son or daughter gone astray? Trouble at work or school? Not enough money to pay your bills? Maybe no job at all. You've come to the end of your rope. You're facing an only by prayer situation. Jesus says there are some things in life that can be solved only by prayer. In the face of the problems we don't know how to deal with, maybe spiritual forces of evil, we must pray. In Mark 9, the father of the demon-possessed boy prayed. He was desperate. His son was possessed by a demon. His son had no life. The father had to spend all his time just keeping his son alive. He had to be on alert 24/7. He was exhausted. Listen to his prayer. This is him talking to Jesus. If you can do anything, take pity on us and help us. Doesn't sound like a very confident prayer, does it? Or very believing? I don't think this man was a prayer warrior. If you can, said Jesus, everything is possible for one who believes. Immediately the boy's father exclaimed, I do believe. Help me overcome my unbelief. This prayer isn't destined for a worship manual. But Jesus cast out the demon and healed the boy. He responded not to the eloquence of the man, but the pain of the man. You don't have to be practiced in prayer. Just cry out to Jesus. Mark records this account to show us that demons are real. Satan and the demonic are powerful. But Mark assures us they're no match for Christ. The demons and Jesus in Mark's account need no introduction. They had battled it out elsewhere, and the demons had no desire for a rematch. The minute the demons meet Jesus, they ask, are you here to torment us? Translation, they're saying, I know that in the end you'll put it to us, but in the meantime, is it double trouble you're going to give us? They crumpled like stringless puppets. In God's presence, Satan is a wimp. The devil is to Christ what a mosquito is to an elephant. Apostle Paul writes, therefore God exalted him, Jesus he's talking about, to the highest place, gave him a name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth. Under the earth means creatures like Satan and the demons who follow him must submit to Jesus. Christ is greater than Satan. No one dared go near the tombs where the Gerasene demon-possessed man roamed, but Jesus walked right up to him. Jesus is not afraid of demons. Apostle John says, he who is in you, he's talking about Christians, he who is in you is greater than he who is in the world. Christ is greater than Satan, far more powerful. Were you faced with fears? Possibly spiritual forces of evil working against you? Maybe there's disharmony in your marriage, problems in your home, troubles at work or at school, or deep discouragement? Call on the name of Jesus, and you will have power to overcome. How does Jesus' power over Satan leave us? Confident. The punchline of this story is Jesus' power over Satan, over demons. One word from Christ, and the demons are swimming with the pigs. Just one command. No chants were said. No candles were lit. Jesus commands and the demons obey. This means you don't need to be afraid to talk to your friends or family members about Christ, what he's doing in your life. For Jesus has power over all the forces of evil. Three, Jesus has compassion for us. In the midst of this dramatic exorcism of a demon and healing, don't miss Jesus' compassion. Everyone left this demon-possessed man alone. No one dared go near him. But Jesus is not afraid of him, and he walks right up to him, cast out the demon, and healed him. Do you wonder why Jesus allowed the demons to go into a herd of pigs? I mean, he must have foreseen what would happen. I think he determined that this was the best way to assure the man of the violent demons that had been cast out of him, as he could see their terrible violence as the herd went over the cliff and into the Lake of Galilee. Then look at verse 18. As Jesus was getting into the boat, the man who had been demon-possessed begged to go with him. Jesus did not let them, but said, "Go home to your own people and tell them how much the Lord has done for you and how he has had mercy on you." The man asked to go with Jesus. He'd been healed. He longed to be with the man who had rescued him. But Jesus says, no. He knew that this man had not had a family life or friends for who knows how long. And that's what he needed. It was better for him to go home and develop relationships with his family and friends. If Jesus was only interested in his spiritual needs, he probably would have had the man come along with him. Under his teaching and his mentorship, the man would have grown in his faith. But Jesus doesn't just care about our spiritual needs. He cares about our social needs and our personal needs. In short, he loves us. He has compassion on us. Then one final thing, way I think this story makes a difference in our lives today. Jesus has a strategy for reaching the world. The man asked to go with Jesus. Instead, Jesus said, "Go home to your own people and tell them how much the Lord has done for you and how he has had mercy on you." So the man went away and began to tell in the Decapolis how much Jesus had done for him. And all the people were amazed. He was the first follower of Christ to speak to people in the Decapolis. Jesus did not ask him to go on tour with him to speak with strangers. He said, no, go home to the people you know, your family, your friends, and share what Christ has done for you. And what a story he had to tell. He had been in anguish. He was the most dreaded, hated man in the region. Can you imagine how much time the city council had spent discussing, what are we going to do with this wild man in the tombs? Jesus changed all of that. Do you think the man was successful in sharing? You bet. Mark says, all the people were amazed. They saw this raving madman now clothed and in his right mind. The change was undeniable. Jesus' strategy is still the same today. You don't have to go door to door to talk to strangers. The best place for you to serve Christ is right in your own home, your own neighborhood, your school, your place of work. Teenagers, God's plan for you is pretty straightforward. Minister for him in your family and with your friends at school. Live a changed life and tell people who did it. Christ simply asks you to share what he's done for you with your friends, relative, work associates, and classmates, people with whom you already have a relationship. You don't have to be a Bible scholar to tell people about Christ. Just live a changed life. They'll see the difference. And tell people what Christ is doing in your life. After Jesus healed the demon-possessed man, I imagine Jesus asked him, "Hey, now that you're healed, what are your plans for the rest of your life? What is it you dream about doing?" And they chat for a while about this man's long-awaited hopes for his life. And then I picture the man turning to Jesus and said, "Well, you asked me about mine. What are your dreams?" And I imagine Jesus responding, "You know, I dream that someday places of worship will be filled with people who lay awake at night thinking how they can help people who have sick bodies, broken souls, hopeless futures, and eternities far from God. I dream of a day when people who follow me will be so filled with the love of God that they go out and share him and encourage people to follow me." That's Jesus' strategy. He wants us to tell people about Jesus, family, friends, and invite them to come to church with us, something at the church where they can learn about Jesus. Jesus says, "I will build my church." He's talking to Peter, "and the gates of Hades will not overcome it." The gates. Gates are defensive, not offensive. You know, with all the things that have happened in our country over the last, decade or more, all the attacks on Christianity, the church has often felt a need to go on the defensive. But the power of the gospel is meant to help us take the fight to the enemy. The power and love of Jesus is meant to break the four walls of the church, and we take to the streets to share with people. And we're confident. But before you can share Christ with others, you have to know Him yourself. The possessed girl and her mother in The Exorcist had no religion. Don't make their mistake. Ignorance about Christ made them open prey for Satan. If you have a relationship with Jesus, you don't have to fear the forces of darkness we see today. Jesus has authority over all forces of darkness. Confident in Jesus' authority, I can go out and talk about what Jesus has done for us and is doing in our lives and invite people to come to know Jesus too. That's it. Let's pray. Father, thank you for this story. And Lord Jesus, we are just amazed by your power over demons, over Satan. And it gives us confidence today that we don't have to be afraid in this world that's pretty scary. I want to give you a moment just to talk to God. You can just pray silently where you are. Maybe you say, I've kind of gotten afraid of forces of darkness, afraid to talk to people. I'm just, seems like so many people are against Christianity. And so God, I don't want to be afraid anymore. Why don't you tell Him that? Tell Him the new confidence you feel today. Or maybe you've never given your life to Christ. Why don't you tell Him right now? You say, I see your power over Satan and forces of darkness, and I want you in my life. I want to make a new start today, and I believe you, the Son of God, you died for me. Come into my life. I'll give you a minute to pray, everybody. Father, thank you for speaking to us through this passage in Mark. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.